We celebrate God's presence with us. So may our Lord's peace be with you. And Debbie Smith. And, well, that was yesterday.
Debbie Smith was yesterday?
No, Kathy's birthday was yesterday.
Just gone, wait, I'm here today. Good morning.
Good morning.
I have silly watch problems again today. How's everyone today?
Great.
Great. We're so glad you're here on this lovely Father's Day, and we appreciate all the fathers that are here and online and across America and the world. Do we have any announcements we would like to share? Audrey?
Yes, excuse me. I asked for it, won't go down. Just a reminder, next Sunday is our fellowship celebration potluck. You know, bring a dish. You know, we need meats and bring main dishes, however. But it's a big celebration. We want everyone to be here. It's right after service next Sunday.
Next Sunday, big celebration. Bring a dish, plan to stay. Bring your specialty.
Yes.
You never know what mine is. It can vary from minute to minute. And you might never have had it before because we substitute lots of things. But anyway, it's going to be a joyous time for all of us to get together and be able to share some special moments together and just be back together, period. Kathy?
Card class will be next Saturday, so let Misty know if you're coming, 10 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall, and hopefully Bible study will resume Tuesday. Jan is still testing positive for COVID, so hopefully we'll hear she's okay and we'll start Bible study Tuesday.
Okay, so hopefully Jan will be over COVID and we'll keep her in our prayers, and hopefully Bible study will start Tuesday. And card class is Saturday. If you want to go, please let Misty Runyon know that you're planning to go so she can have enough supplies. Jim?
We're going to have a very special get-together next Friday night to cut grass. What time is that?
5:30.
5:30-ish.
6 o'clock.
If you're in the neighborhood, drop by and help with some yard work. More importantly, in our board meeting last week, we discussed that, you know, particularly with the summer solstice coming up, we have people that are, I know a couple that are out of town right now. We need to get as many folk in as we can. And what we would ask is that everyone have, Richard has supplied everyone with a directory. If you can get your hands on it, look through and think of somebody who's a member that you haven't seen in a while, and get in touch with them, and next week would be an excellent time for them to come and have fellowship.
Absolutely.
What was the first thing you said?
Grass.
You can't be saying two things at one time. I mean, I got this much memory. So, next Friday, there's going to be a special party here at the church. Plan to come. Bring a sweatband. Bring utensils that might clip things. And it's going to be a surprise grass cutting party. So it should be a lot of fun. The second thing is we're trying to increase membership. So look through the new directory, see who hasn't been here for a while. If you have a friend that you think might want to join us, bring people. We're going to have a great time. It's kind of going to be like a homecoming next weekend with church. So bring people that haven't been here for a while. Bring yourself, bring food. Be here for church. Okay. Did I see another hand? Ginger.
At camp this past week, we noticed that some of the buildings at the YMCA camp the children go to could use a little TLC. So we are doing a region-wide camp cleanup spruce-up at YMCA Camp Chandler in Wetumpka, September 30th. October 1st, that weekend, anyone from the region is invited, and if you can't make it, if you want to donate supplies, cleaning supplies, tools, anything like that, I can take them up.
Great. Awesome. So you're going to go by your little girl self?
I mean, probably.
Okay. They're going to have a cleanup at Camp Chandler. It's in Watumpka, Alabama. Ginger's gonna plan to go. If you'd like to send things up, get them to the church and she will take them. If you'd like to send yourself up, that will be awesome. I'm sure you could probably ride with her. If you have any questions, see Ginger. Anybody else? If not, let us start our worship. Dances in creation, who embraces us with human love, who shakes our lives like thunder, bless us and drive us out with power to fill the world with justice. Amen. Please open your songbooks to number 59, and we're going to sing verses 1 and 2. This is my Father's world. Told us we had to be, well, we have to be nice. Well, I think you tell us that every day. Anyway, I had a mother in crisis Monday, and I helped her out and helped her with her baby and got her a safe ride home. And so I want you to know your little thoughts count.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Uh-huh. Well, that being said, I have nothing to say today.
The end.
So, you know, during this summer, we see lots of flowers and lots of birds and lots of butterflies and lots of colorful things. And we see people, all shapes and all sizes and all colors. because something's pretty doesn't make it nice. You can see some really pretty flowers, and guess what? They're poisonous.
Or they have thorns.
And they have thorns. Bugs know this. They're enticed by sweet smells, and they go someplace, and pretty soon there's somebody's lunch. Yes, sir. And there's also a pitcher that they get down in, and it's full of water, and they can't get out. But they're pretty. They look nice. How many people do you know that look nice that aren't nice inside? You ever know one?
Mm-hmm.
I think we've all known at least one, if not more. And that's unfortunate. But what do people think when they see us? Do they look at you and go, that's a really nice person? No matter what you look like, maybe your hair's a little frazzled or whatever. Or do they look at you and go,
she's a little crazy.
A little crazy. And then I thought, as a Christian, have you ever heard somebody say, I'm a Christian? And thought, if that's a Christian, I don't want to be one. Yeah, there have been people that profess to be Christians and then are the most hateful people you've ever known.
Mm-hmm.
So what are they not doing? They're not fulfilling their Christian duty. They are taking the word Christian and making it for themselves just so people will think that they're great. They have no problems. And they're nice. And that's not what happens. Now, there are a lot of times we put on our Christian face, so to speak, and somebody will cut in front of you or run over you with a basket or something of this nature. And if you look at you, think about your face, does it go to a Christian face? No. It goes to a very unfriendly face. And you can bring it right back after the incident is over. And everybody is going to have those things. It's not going to be a perfect life. God never promised you a rose garden. He never promised you a perfect life. He said he would be there with you and for you. So this week, we're going to try to be as Christian as we can, even in situations that are unhappy or annoying. Sometimes it's the small things that annoy us, isn't it? But with that being said, we're going to think back. And who is with us, guiding us? God is. He knows what you're going through. And he's giving you the choice to either explode or to enjoy. It's hard to enjoy annoying people. But you can enjoy life. And show them that it doesn't have to be annoying. It can be a lovely way in this world. So I challenge you this week, put on your Christian face and try not to let it slide. How about that? Think we can do that for a week?
Do I get brownie points for last week?
Nope.
This is a 1 week at a time thing, so now you got to do something next week.
We got COVID in the center, so it's hard.
Yes, we want to pray for all those who are suffering through that because it's getting to be bad again.
But we'll try.
We'll try. Okay, I think we'll all try. Let us pray. Dear the Father, we know that there are times even the small things annoy us, and we put on that face that lets people know it's annoying. You're annoying. But this week, dear Father, let us put on that Christian face, even when we're being annoyed. Sometimes a smile can change things. And if we smile, and if we use our Christian words and our Christian actions, maybe we can let them know that they are loved by you also. Please help us in the coming week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And thank you for coming.
Yes.
as Judy's going back to her seat, it seems to me through the years that you've talked a lot about people cutting you off in traffic. So, yeah, I see the theme there.
When
so,
I was a driver,
yeah,
that was very prominent in this
hour. On a serious note, I would believe that that is perhaps the most significant reason that the church is numerically in decline, or people see an inconsistency between faith and action. So, yeah, I think you're on to something there, Judy. So, okay. Joys of the week, Wes?
Yesterday, a group of us went up to Mossy Head to celebrate Kathy's birthday at the Panhandle Opry, not to be confused with opera, which some people did, but it was a surprise for a lot of us, but it was a very, very good, enjoyable time, and there are some of us that are thinking about going back again, so we enjoyed celebrating Kathy's birthday that way.
Yeah, Kathy's birthday at the Panhandle Opera in probably downtown Mossy Head, I guess.
Oh, no, it was way out in...
Not in downtown.
Oh, way out in nowhere else.
Huh. So those of us who think that Mossy Head is in the boonies,
it's in the boonies,
is
really,
the
really
boonies to Mossy Head. So. Kate?
I'm going to be going to Wisconsin this week to celebrate a middle school and high school friend's wedding. So travel prayers and celebration to have this lifelong friend and be able to go reconnect after a few years, you know, and so be good.
Wow. Traveling to...
Egg Harbor, Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. It's like an hour north of Green Bay.
Wow. Mm-hmm. That'll be a trip.
Yep.
Connie Schabowski, welcome home.
During this recent medical crisis with my daughter, she is doing very well. She's back to work, and so getting stronger every day. And so she still needs some prayers for a couple of things that she's really having issues with. But God is good, and I feel blessed.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Shannon Schabowski back at work. Wonderful.
Yes. Yeah. And she works at a hospital, so.
So Jason Clark at our first service, his rehab with his knees coming along well. Audrey?
Well, I'm going to consider this a blessing, actually, but my uncle, Steve Holder, passed away this week. It is sadness, but it's a blessing because he's had Alzheimer's and dementia for a couple years, and he was just like just a body and nothing else. And we've all prayed that God would bring him home and make him well. So he's home now, and thank you all for all the prayers.
Ginger?
From Facebook, Laura Avery has her mom has finally found out what is wrong and will be getting treatment soon. She was diagnosed with sudden CSF, and that is brain fluid leakage. So she will be getting treatment, and they're happy that they finally have figured out what is wrong.
Sudden CFF?
CSF.
CSF. Wow.
She recently had a fall, but she really didn't injure herself. She just had to have the fire department come and help her up. Shades of Avis, but She is doing well. I was able to visit with her for a couple of hours, so she is truly a blessing to my life and to the Christian faith.
Wonderful. Connie Schabowski's friend on our prayer concerns, Beverly Dean, doing well, it sounds like. May we be in a spirit of prayer. May our Lord be with you.
Thank you.
Loving God, we give thanks for the praises of this day, for friendship and celebration and relief from uncertainty, relief from not knowing what lies ahead, I guess. But Lord, we know that whatever lies ahead, that you are with us. We may not know the future, but we know who holds the future. So we pause and give thanks for your holy presence with us. We celebrate your resurrection, Lord. The gift of life over death, the gift of victory over any obstacle. Help us to be diligent in our faith, though, and to match our actions with who we proclaim to be. Lord, we remember those on our prayer list and other additions. Lord, we pray for Jan Pooley, who is enduring COVID.
Lord, hear our prayers.
We pray for Laura Avery's mother and the fight, the battle with the sudden CSF.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Audrey?
We just found out that one of our local businesses, the Neighborhood Cafe, the owner, Richard, had passed away this past week. Prayer for that family.
Lord, we pray with Audrey for Richard, the owner of the Neighborhood Cafe that passed away recently.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Yes, Ginger?
Laura also has asked for prayers. Mark is having a heart catheter surgery this week, and she is having surgery on Friday.
Okay. Her surgery is Friday then?
Yes.
Okay. Lord, we pray for the Averys, with the Averys, as Mark goes through a heart catheterization. And Laura has the first of her surgeries for her feet.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Joy?
I have a couple. My sister-in-law, Katie Wessinger, will be having a heart cath this week. Amy Montz was rushed to the hospital with a kidney stone, trying to pass it. She's in extreme pain. And one more is Vicki and Don, travel prayers as they go to Washington State, that everything goes well with the journey, and they have a wonderful visit. They'll be gone for about 3 weeks.
Lord, we pray for, along with Joy and many of us, for her sister Katie Wessinger, as she has a heart cath procedure.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for Amy Muntz, suffering through a kidney stone.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And we pray that you'll be with Don and Vicki Christ in their extensive road trip to Washington State.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Judy?
fourth anniversary of Wesley's death and another person's hands. It still affects the boys.
Certainly.
Thank you.
Lord, we pray for the Moore family, especially Paul and Michael, and going through some sad memories and sad events in their life. Lord,
hear our prayers.
Okay. Kathy?
Please remember I've asked prayers before for Kathy Helm Fry. She's my classmate. She is terminal, so just prayers for her.
What was the last name?
Fry, F-R-Y-E.
Okay, Kathy Fry. We pray along with Kathy for her friend, classmate Kathy Fry, is critical health.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord, many friends and family come to mind when we open our minds and hearts to who needs a special touch from you, Lord. So we pray for those that we have mentioned. And as we continue in prayer, we lift our hearts to the to share the words of faith and prayer that Jesus shared. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Our message in music is one that will probably bring a smile to our faces from years ago. Richard has a recording of Walt Kraft as he sings the song He.
But I would like to sing a song that is directed specifically to our Heavenly Father. Thank you.
you want to follow along in the Pew Bible, it's on page 68. Luke 8, 26 through 39. Then they arrived at the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee. As he stepped out on land, a man of the city who had demons met him. For a long time he had worn no clothes, and he did not live in a house but in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he fell down before him and shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man, for many times it had seized him. He was kept under guard, bound with chains and shackles, but he would break the bonds and be driven by the demons into the wild. Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" He said, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. They begged him not to order them to go back into the abyss. Now there on the hillside, a large herd of swine was feeding, and the demons begged Jesus to let them enter these, so he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and the swine and entered the swine, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When the swine herds saw what had happened, they ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came out to see what had happened. And when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by demons had been healed. Then all of the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. So he got into the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might be with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." So he went away proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. May God add his blessing to this reading.
A few years ago, well, actually, quite a few years ago, I shared a message about this text, and I titled the sermon "Deviled Ham." How many of you remember deviled ham? Okay, a few of us. Yeah, Underwood deviled ham. We don't remember it too much now, but it seemed like there used to be a lot of commercials about the deviled ham. Well, I said at that time, part of my job is to get you to remember the accounts of Jesus and tie them into your everyday life. And my intention is to always have us associating Jesus' power and Jesus' teaching in a practical way in our lives. So today, I'm going to work with you a little bit, and every time I say deviled ham, your response will be, "Jesus heals us from our demons." Deviled ham.
Jesus heals us from our demons.
Okay, so far so good. Today our text deals with many of the sensitivities of the Jewish piety. Pigs were the personification of uncleanliness. They were also associated with Gentile uncleanliness. In addition, tombs were the source or a source of uncleanliness. And in Jewish areas, these tombs were whitewashed. So you had less chance, in theory, to touch one of those tombstones. You remember Jesus made an analogy with the religious leaders, and he called them whitewashed tombs at times because they were clean on the outside but unclean on the inside. So sort of what Judy was alluding to there with our Christian face should match what we do. So, we have a man here. Also, he was wearing no clothes. So, he's an outcast. Nakedness was extremely shameful in that day. But when Jesus arrives, it only took him a few moments to overcome all those sources of uncleanness. So we have deviled ham.
Jesus saves us from our demons.
Excellent. No question about it, our modern ears have a little trouble hearing this story. I believe we would understand it better if this poor man in the graveyard were described as someone who had mentally ill issues, because that would be in our keeping, or in our thinking of Jesus's healing. In the first century theology, as Luke is here, it is not that way. They were more comfortable giving credit or blame, I guess, to unseen spiritual beings. We would rather not do that, but we do understand Jesus's power. His power over afflictions, which are legion, many in this case. But that's only part of the story. This is a story about more than just healing. This is about Jesus actually confronting evil and that language of the first century theologian. The townspeople had been content to deal with evil by isolating it on the outskirts of their society, the graveyard. Kind of like us, if we're uncomfortable, we kind of tend to push things to the side, and we don't want to think about that. If there's anything we can learn today, we have to understand that we have to deal with the so-called demons in our lives. And Jesus, today as he was then, is prepared to eradicate that. Possibly we also get caught up in the story and miss another major point, and that Jesus has the power to overcome demons that infest our age. And I believe that is a major point that Luke wants us to hear from this deviled ham.
Jesus heals us from our demons.
Our deviled ham story. Remember, Luke was a physician. And even though he had a primitive understanding, he still discerned a great deal about the nature of human beings and illness. He was aware also of the supernatural influence of evil and people's reaction to those people who were possessed by demons. In Luke's world, demons were supernatural creatures who took control of an individual when they were not expecting it. They made individuals act in ways that were not acceptable. It was as if the individual was not there, and the demon became central in all that a person did. Please understand, a demon was different than sin. You see, sin is what an individual did. It was the disobedience of the will of God. But the demon took control of the individual beyond the area of sin. You were not yourself, and the demon and the self were in constant struggle for control. So by chaining up and shackling this man, his friends, I guess, or people at least that cared some, were trying to help him so he wouldn't hurt himself. In fact, if you go to Mark's version of the story, Mark says that the man would use stones and bruise himself and try to hurt himself. So there's a similar story in Mark. Much of it is here. But more than once, the people asked, after they saw Jesus' impact here, who is this that control even the demons? Now, Jesus was coming into this situation after the calming of the storm with the disciples. He was coming across the Sea of Galilee and landed here and was approached by this man who was not in his right mind here. things, I hope we realize that there are demons in our world, but deviled ham.
Jesus heals us from our demons.
And we speak of demons all the time. Drug addiction is a demon. Addicts always speak of being possessed by the need of chemical demons. All the addictive drugs are legion in the battle for human souls, I guess. Power is a demon, and it not only affects individuals, it also affects nations. Nations who seek to control and maintain power over others without a sense of the need for justice and mercy. And when that power rises to a crescendo, we see the results in groups like the KKK or the Taliban or Al-Qaeda or other groups that thrive on hatred and fear. Illness is a demon we face. With all of our scientific expertise, you would think that we would be able to deal more effectively with this demon. In all likelihood, illness was the so-called demon in our story today. But illness and mental illness is still a powerful and divisive issue. It seems like it comes with a curse, and we often treat victims as outcasts, people to be shunned or isolated. And speaking of illness, the words cancer and AIDS make us squirm with discomfort and fear. Fear is a demon. Before Will Smith recently got himself in a little bit of a controversy, there was a timely quote that I remember from a character he played in the 2013 movie, After Earth. His character had this quote: "The danger is very, very real. Fear is a choice. Fear is not real. The only place that fear can exist is in our thoughts of the future. It is a product of our imagination causing us to fear things that do not at present and may not ever exist." Fear. Not at present and may never exist. Fear is near insanity. So the demon of fear piggybacks on the demons of illness, and people sometimes run away instead of seeking the support that's offered. Sometimes we think if we ignore it long enough, it'll go away. Fear and illness, kind of a double demon that can emotionally and spiritually paralyze us. Greed is a demon. It threatens to make us slaves of want. And avarice has always been one of the deadly sins, but the desire to have and to hold is now something that our society prizes and encourages. Things become more important than people, sometimes more important than faith. The demons are out there. And as Scripture reminds us today, demons are legion. They enslave the individual, destroy the valuable, and evoke the very worst in us. So the way that we cope with them is to come face to face with the one who can overcome and drive out our demons. In a way, it is up to us, because we need to be willing to sit at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in our right minds. Then we can be at peace with ourselves, with others, and with God. Deviled ham.
Jesus heals us from our demons.
Yes. Yes, like legion, we can be at peace with the world. Dear Abby once carried an article. This is a long time ago, but I thought it was excellent. 1990. That seems like a long time ago, doesn't it?
30 years.
30 years.
32.
some people were in diapers at that point.
Some people, yes.
It's a story about a wealthy family and a young man named Bill, we'll call him. Well, in that area with the wealthy environment there, it was a tradition when a person graduated from high school, it was a custom that the parents gave them an automobile for graduation. Bill and his father had spent months looking for just the right car. And the week before graduation, they found the perfect car, and Bill was certain that on graduation night, that car would be his. Well, after the graduation ceremonies, Bill had a surprise. Bill's father handed him a gift-wrapped Bible. Bill was more than disappointed, more than angry. Bill took the Bible and threw it down and left the house and left his family. He never spoke to his father again. His parents tried to contact him, but Bill didn't even read the letters that they sent him. When his parents died, Bill did come home and started to sort through the possessions that he inherited, and he came across the Bible that his father gave him on graduation night. It was rather dusty, for it had sat on a shelf, but Bill brushed away the dust and opened it to find inside a cashier's check for the amount of the car that Bill and his father had chosen together. It's a sad story, and it's a tragic commentary to how demons can get a hold of us and take over us. We don't know what happened about Bill. Maybe he read the Bible. Perhaps he finally figured out that he had many lessons to learn. That's true for all of us. But one of the lessons that I want us to realize today is we don't have to be at war with ourselves or with other people. And more than that, we do not have to be at war with God. When we look at Jesus, we see what God is like and what God wants us to be like. Jesus shows us the love, the compassion, and the concern and the empathy in the Father's eyes as God sees us. And that's the good news of our faith. Jesus reveals that God looks at us not with angry, vengeful, condemning eyes, but with the eyes of love. So in our story today, Jesus came into Legion's life saying, "I can control and heal you from your demons if you will let me." Likewise, we have deviled ham.
Jesus heals us from our demons.
I was reading about one of my college buddies posted on Facebook that he received an award from University of Illinois, a Distinguished Alumni Award. It's a pretty big deal. And he's had a great career, and it had an article about his career, and one of his quotes, which struck a chord with me when I read it. He said, "We need a plan, but it's not the plan that is important. It's about preparation and resilience." Preparation and resilience. When we come to the table, those two words should resonate with us. Preparation and resilience. Jesus had prepared the disciples, although they probably didn't realize it at that point, but he had prepared the disciples to be resilient in carrying the faith forward. Perhaps this is where we prepare to be resilient with our faith. Repeatedly, we hear these words about the plan that Jesus had, how his body would be broken, how his blood would be shed. Once again, they should resonate with us as we hear, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat, all of you. And this is my blood shed for your sins. This is the new covenant in my blood, the covenant that I have prepared for the world, that God the Father has prepared for the world, actually, through me. Take and drink, all of you." Plans are important, but preparation and resilience helps us live out our life of faith. And every time we come to this table and eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we remember the love of our Lord that prepares us to be resilient.
Table, God stands with open arms. Let us go to him in prayer. O most gracious God, through the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, you have made this covenant with you available to us. We accept and we come to you now. We pray that you always keep us mindful of the gift of the broken body, the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross, now and forever. Amen. Jesus took the bread, gave it to his disciples. He passed the cup, and they all drank of it.
I have a poem I'd like to share from an unknown author, and it's called The Strength of a Mountain. God took the strength of a mountain, the majesty of a tree, the warmth of summer sun, the calm of quiet sea, the generous soul of nature, the comforting arm of night, wisdom of the ages and powers of eagle's flight, the joy of a morning in spring, the faith of a mustard seed, the patience of eternity, the depth of family need. Then God combined these qualities when there was nothing more to add. He knew his masterpiece was complete, and so he called it Dad. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, today we ask you to bless our earthly fathers for the many times they reflected the love and strength, generosity, wisdom, and mercy that you exemplify in your relationship with us as your children. We honor our fathers for putting our needs above their own convenience and comfort, for teaching us to show courage and determination in the face of adversity, for challenging us to move beyond self-limiting boundaries, for modeling the qualities that would turn us into the responsible, principled, caring adults. We pray that our fathers who have passed into the next life have been welcomed into your loving embrace, and that our family will one day be reunited in the heavenly kingdom. In whom your Son entrusted us, we ask your gracious blessings today and every day. Amen.
I mentioned toward the end of my message that in Jesus we see what God is like. Perhaps the song that we learned, or maybe our very first song, was Jesus Loves Me. It had to be early, if not the first song. But I think that is the truth that we, that Christians reflect. Judy, you started off with a good message, that Christians reflect that Jesus loves not only us, but the world. If you've never taken a step of faith and trusted Jesus to be your Lord, to be your Savior, today is a time that the time is right for. So as we stand and share this praise hymn to Jesus, if a commitment is on your heart, please come and we stand together. This week says, God keeps his promises. God's promise is to love us, never leave us or forsake us, always be with us. So with that in mind, we share our closing chorus as we have concluded our worship here in the sanctuary.
Thank you.
our Father, children, all are we. May we walk with each other in perfect harmony. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.